Society, Chapter 5, Religion and Thought. Pre-monotheistic Ethiopia. Both pre-Christian and post-Christian inscriptions, i.e. those before and after AD 330, indicate early serpent worship in Ethiopian mythology. The father of the Queen of Sheba was said to have been the first human king to be crowned and worshipped. He gained this status according to age-old Ethiopian beliefs. After he killed the serpent king known by the name of Arwe, Litaman, 1947. It is interesting to note that the Ethiopian term for king, Negus, literally the crowned, is similar to the Jewish term Nachash, which means serpent. Confirming the old belief, a relief picture of a serpent can be seen on one of the fallen stelae of Aksum. Just like in other societies of the Near East, the worship of the serpent was prevalent during the early period. The Persians also have a similar legend, as recounted in the Holy Persian Book of Avesta. Ancient Persians worshipped a serpent king called Adjis-Bahaka. Judaism also has deep roots in pre-Christian Ethiopia. The first clear proof, as recounted in the biblical book of Acts, is that the Ethiopian eunuch, who was converted to Christianity by Jesus' disciple Philip, was reading the book of Isaiah, circa AD 50. Furthermore, the first century Jewish historian Josephus traces Jewish influence on Ethiopia to the time of the Queen of Sheba. He said in his writing that the Queen of Sheba, Queen of Ethiopia, who also ruled Egypt, went to Jerusalem and met Solomon, from whom she acquired his wisdom. Then later during the pre-Christian period, the worship of particular gods became widespread. This is also clearly seen on statues, pagan altars, and temples found in northern Ethiopia. The gods worshipped were many. In the ancient pagan temples of Yeha, which was built during approximately the 6th century BC, the religious edifice was dedicated to a god named Almoka. Another temple in Melazo, built circa the 55th century BC, is also dedicated to Almoka. Other known pagan gods of the period were Aster, Bahir, Medre, and Mahram, as included in one of Emperor Ezana's pre-Christian inscriptions. The crescent and the sun were worshipped for hundreds of years. An incense burner discovered at Adi Gelemo has distinct crescent and sun symbols in its upper part. At Kaskase, one can still see an altar with Ethiopic writings that bears the symbols of the crescent and the sun separating the letters. Emperor Ezana's scribes also used the crescent and the sun to separate letters until the monarch was converted to Christianity AD 330, at which time the symbols were replaced by the cross. His description of himself also changed from the son of Ares to the servant of the Lord of Heaven. It is important to note that all the inscriptions of Ethiopian emperors prior to Ezana have words separated by the symbols of the crescent and the sun. All the coins of the Ethiopian emperors preceding Ezana also featured words separated by the picture of the crescent and the sun. Ethiopia and the Greek connection. In Hellenic mythology, Ethiopia was prominently portrayed. The famous Greek poet Homer, who lived in the 9th century AD, wrote in the Iliad about the blameless Ethiopians. He asserted that they were visited by Zeus, the king of the gods, by the goddess Iris, who traveled to their country to participate in their sacrificial rites, and by Poseidon, the sea god, who lingered delight at their feast. Later in the 1st century BC, another Greek historian, Diodorus Siculus, wrote that the god Hercules and Bacchus were both awed by the piety of the Ethiopians, whose sacrifices were the most acceptable to the gods. Clearly, the Ethiopians of antiquity were part of the religious mythology of ancient civilizations, and they worshipped gods of similar type. Ethiopia and the Judaic connection. There is no doubt that Judaic influences and Old Testament reflections had reached Ethiopia long before the introduction of Christianity in AD 340, and before the Bible was translated into Ethiopic. That is why the Ethiopian eunuch was reading the book of Isaiah during the time of the apostles. There are several different explanations for this Jewish connection. One is that Jewish influence came from the direction of Egypt. Religious historians supporting this view base their argument on what the prophet in the Old Testament recorded more than 2,000 years ago with reference to Nubia and northern Abyssinia, which were then referred to together as Ethiopia. The prophet Isaiah, 740-701 BC, basing his information on eyewitness accounts, mentioned the Nile, tributaries that divide Ethiopia, and the papyrus reed boats still used at the source of the Nile. The land of the rustling of wings, which is beyond the rivers of Ethiopia, that sends ambassadors by the sea, even in vessels of papyrus on the waters. Go you swift messengers to a nation tall and smooth, to a people awesome from their beginning onward, a nation that measures out and threads down, whose land the rivers divide. Isaiah 18:2. The prophet Jeremiah 627-587 BC wrote of Jews in the country of Patros, which was southern Egypt, adjacent to ancient Ethiopia. Jeremiah 15:8. The prophet Zephaniah 640-609 BC referred to Jewish settlers in Cush when he wrote, "From beyond the rivers of Cush, my suppliants, my dispersed community shall bring my offering." Zephaniah chapter 3 verse 10. This proves that Jews had penetrated as far as ancient Nubia and northwestern Ethiopia hundreds of years before the birth of Christ. The Greek historian Herodotus, 485-425 BC, described Egyptian garrisons believed to be of Jewish extraction who were neglected and left in Elephantine, an island in the River Nile on the borders of ancient Egypt and Ethiopia. He recounted that when they were left on duty for 3 years without being relieved, they revolted against the 26th dynasty Egyptian pharaoh, Psammetichos II, 593-588 BC, and went to Ethiopia. Herodotus refers to the deserters as asmach and adds, "This word asmach signifies, when translated into the tongue of the Hellenists, those who stand on the left hand of the king." Interestingly, similar to the Ethiopian title Gra Asmach, which means those who stand on the left side of the king during combat. 240,000 Egyptians of the warrior class revolted and went over to the Ethiopians. From the city of Elephantine, the Egyptians had served as outpost for 3 years and no one relieved them from their guard. Accordingly, they took counsel together and, adopting a common plan, they all in a body revolted from Psammetichos and set out for Ethiopia. When they came to Ethiopia, they gave themselves over to the king of the Ethiopians, and he rewarded them. There were certain of the Ethiopians who had come to be at variance with him, and he bade them drive these out of and dwell in their land. So since these men settled in the land of the Ethiopians, the Ethiopians have come to be of milder manners from having learnt the customs of the Egyptians. Herodotus, Book 2. The Aramaic papyri of the 5th century BC also mentioned the same incidents. It is perfectly reasonable to assume that the Beit Israel, formerly referred to as Falashas, or Ethiopian Jews, had a connection of these episodes. In the Bible, the earliest reference to Ethiopia is found in Genesis, which refers to the river Gihon, Nile, which it says compassed the whole of Ethiopia. And the book of Numbers points out that Moses married an Ethiopian woman. It is recounted in the Old Testament that around 1000 BC, the Queen of Sheba traveled to Jerusalem to visit King Solomon. 1 Kings 9:1, 10:2, Chronicles 9:1, 9. Matthew chapter 12, verse 42, Luke chapter 12, verse 32. Ethiopian sources have elaborations on the episode, with the queen begetting a son from Solomon, who established the Solomonian dynasty that lasted until Haile Selassie I in the second half of the 20th century. Ethiopian sources, supported by the Coptic history of the patriarchs of Alexandria, have always equated Ethiopia with the kingdom of Saba. They have also claimed that Sheba and Solomon's offspring, Menelik I, brought with him to Ethiopia the Ark of the Covenant, which Ethiopian Christians believe has been preserved to present day at the Church of Zion in Aksum, and which is a centerpiece of the country's Christian Orthodox denomination. A detailed explanation of this was given in a book called Kebre Negesht, Glory of the Kings, translated from Coptic in the early 14th century, and was elaborated on by an Armenian writer named Abu Salih, who pointed out that Abyssinia, Ethiopia, is the kingdom of Sheba, and that the Ethiopians possessed the Ark of the Covenant, which was looked after by Israelites. Some old Yemeni manuscripts have portrayed the Queen of Sheba as being born to an Ethiopian mother named Azeb and a Yemeni father called Sharhabil. The fact that Ethiopia ruled over Saudi Arabia on and off for hundreds of years during antiquity may have something to do with this, but many Eurocentric historians have depicted the Queen of Sheba as being from Yemen, not Ethiopia. Moses of Ethiopia. Moses of Ethiopia, AD 330 to 405, also known as Abba Musa or Moses the Black, was an Ethiopian who was in the service of an Egyptian official of high authority in the early part of the Christian era. His biography, written in Coptic by Egypt's Bishop Palladius, recounts that initially Moses lived a life of evil, which included larceny, murder, and leadership of a gang of 75 thieves. At one time, he swung across the Nile with a sword between his teeth to kill a shepherd against whom he had rancor. It was said that during this attempt to kill a rival, he saw a vision. Upon hearing of the ascetics of the western desert, Moses, who had now repented, entered the monastery of Petra in the Egyptian desert of Skete. Despite constant temptations, he passed a harmonious religious life with Saint Isidore and Saint Macurias at the monastery. After being an ascetic, he dedicated his life to helping all those in need. Between his long fast, he carried out manual work to feed the needy. Theophilus, Archbishop of Alexandria, heard of Moses' virtue and ordained him a Coptic Christian minister. In his old age, Moses founded a monastery on his own and led 75 disciples, all of whom followed his example. In AD 405, Moses, who was 75 years of age, and all his company of monks who refused to heed his warnings and instead remained behind to gain martyrdom, like him, were murdered by the Mazesis, a vicious group of barbarian burglars in the monastery of Dais al-Barumus, which Moses had founded. He was soon raised to sainthood by the Coptic See of Alexandria and is as legendary in Coptic circles as Saint Jeremy is among Catholics. Abba Musa is recognized as a special religious leader in the Ethiopian and Coptic Synaxarium, and his date of remembrance is 24th Sani, July 1st. The well-known German scholar Otto Meinardus recently commented that Moses of Ethiopia became the first martyr of the Desert Fathers. Meinardus, OFA 1962, Atlas of Christian Sites in Egypt, Le Caire, Société d'Archéologie Copte, page 31. However, as long ago as the 1st century AD, Flavius Josephus, the Jewish scholar and historian, asserted that the Queen of Sheba who visited Solomon was from Africa, not from Arabia. He specifically referred to her as the Queen of Egypt and Ethiopia. There are many other references that connect ancient Ethiopia with Judaism. The Book of Amos compares the Ethiopians with the Israelites when it cites God as asking the Jewish people, are you not as the children of the Ethiopians to me? Amos 9 and 7. That is why the Abyssinian tradition developed the idea that Ethiopia had become the new Israel. It should not be surprising, therefore, that some Ethiopian emperors of antiquity engraved on their coins the title King of Kings, e.g., the coin of King Indibus in the 3rd century AD. More than all these, however, the Ethiopian monarchy and the Ethiopian Orthodox Church have cherished a passage from the Psalms where King David proclaims, "Ethiopia shall soon stretch out her hands to God." Psalm 68, verse 31. Jewish and Old Testament connections through South Arabia are even more abundant, and the evidence of Jewish migration into Ethiopia from its South Arabian realm is irrefutable. Rabbinical literature also abounds with references to Jewish connections with the Ethiopian ruled areas of Arabia. In Midrash Bamidbar Rabbah and the Talmud Bamidbar Rabbah Naso 934, there is a record by R. Akiba, who traveled to Yemen to arouse the Jewish diaspora against the Romans, that the king of the Arabs was dark-skinned. It is also revealed in the passage that an Ethiopian king ruled areas in South Arabia at that time. This was AD 130. The mention of dark complexion was undoubtedly a reference to the brown face of the Ethiopian ruler. That a sizable number of the Jewish diaspora with their monotheistic faith migrated to Yemen following the destruction of the first and then the second temple in 538 BC and AD 70, respectively, is clear. Ample evidence exists that there was a thriving Jewish diaspora in Arabia. The very last Himyarite king, Dehu Nuas, who was converted to Judaism and defeated by the Aksumite general Abraha, is a well-known case. After that conquest, Ethiopia had total control over South Arabia, and during that time, a mass exodus of Jews to Ethiopia took place. The fact that they subsequently crossed over to Aksum, which was one of the foremost powerful kingdoms in the world and ruled South Arabia itself, cannot be disputed. It is the Jewish connection to Ethiopia and the late migration of Jewish settlers from South Arabia that is the root of the Beit Israel, Ethiopian Jewish phenomenon. This long historical connection going back to the times of Moses and ushering in the mass migration during Ethiopia's rule over South Arabia has left a strong residue of Jewish religious tradition in Ethiopia. Some Jews stuck to their faith even under heavy persecution, and at one time even succeeded in taking over power from the Aksumite Christians. By the time of Ahmad Gragnas' conquest in the mid-1500s, they no longer had hegemony over the state but were controlling a major province. A sizable number of Beit Israel converted to Christianity and introduced Hebraic rites and religious elements into the Ethiopian Tewahedo Church. For all these reasons, a notion has developed among Ethiopian church scholars that the Ethiopians have become the legitimate successors to the Jews who have failed to accept Jesus as the true Mashiach. Among the royal honors of the emperors of Ethiopia up to the time of Haile Selassie I was the title conquering lion of the tribe of Judah. Ethiopian Christians used the official shield of David and seal and net of Solomon. The Ethiopian Orthodox Tewahedo Christians believe that they have in their custody the tabernacle of the law of God, i.e. the Ark of the Covenant, which they refer to as the Tabot, brought from Jerusalem by Menelik, the son of Solomon and the Queen of Sheba. When Ethiopian Christians carry the Tabot out of the church during celebrations such as Epiphany, their rituals and ceremonial practices are strikingly similar to those of ancient Israel. In many ways, Ethiopian Orthodox tradition mimics a Jewish religious practice. The clergy surrounded the Tabot or Ark, sing in praise of God, use musical instruments such as sistrum and the drum, and dance. This is similar to the carrying of the scroll containing the 5 books of Moses to the accompaniment of song and dance, and the beating and rattling of musical instruments, especially during the feast of Sirnhat Torah, which commemorates the scene in the second chapter of Samuel where David and the people danced about the ark. Antiphonal singing, which is a major feature of Ethiopian Orthodox Mass, is another form of Jewish liturgy being practiced in Ethiopian Tewahedo Christianity. In both Ethiopian Orthodox and Jewish musical practice, there is a use of a falsetto element and trilling. Also, Ethiopian Orthodox depteras and Judaic priests make use of the staff in religious celebrations. Timket is the festival of Epiphany. The celebration falls on January 19th, 2 weeks following the Ethiopian Christmas known as Gana. It is, in fact, a three-day celebration held in memory of Christ's baptism in the Jordan River. Timket takes place during the last days of the rainy season in August, when the country starts to change dramatically. The sun glows with utmost brightness from a gleaming blue sky, and the religious carnival of Timket always expires in this ideal weather. Everyone is well dressed for the occasion. There is even a saying, Le Timket Yalhone Emis Yebetatis, which means a vest that is not worn during the Timket celebrations may as well be cut to pieces. All persons, whether adults or children, look shimmering for the three-day emotional gala. The end of the day on January 18th is called Ketera, and at that particular time, the priests remove the tablets, the replicas of the Ark of the Covenant, from each church and monastery and ordain the water in a pool or river to purify it, where the next day a grand festival takes place. The priests carefully deposit the tablets in specially prepared tents in the field, each deacon raising a lofty standard or picture portraying the churches or monastery saint. People engage in merrymaking. The pastor sprinkles water over the converged congregation in memory of Christ's baptism in the Jordan River. Once baptism is over, the tabots are again graciously transported back to their particular locations, followed by the devout. The procession accompanying the tabots winds through the roads again as horsemen with alluring and garlanded attire gallop on the edges, ending the procession at the gates of the church. In extra religious practices, Ethiopian Orthodox Depteras Church scholars employ magical formulae similar to those used in ancient Israel. Many of the words inscribed, e.g. Elohi Adonai, are exactly similar. Both attempt to invoke spells to disperse demons or to cure diseases. Like their Jewish counterpart, Ethiopian Depteras use amulets and tefillin for presumed best effect. In both Ethiopian Orthodox Christianity and Judaism, there is a twofold division of the priesthood. In ancient Israel, the clergy were divided into priests and Levites, the latter being responsible for conducting the ritual of hymns. Similarly, in the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, there is a division of the clergy into two. Priest and depteras, the latter being responsible for choral functions. There are many Hebrew terms associated with the temple that have been adopted in Ethiopian circles. For example, the word for Eucharist is kurban, Hebrew kurban, and the term for a high priest is kahin, Hebrew kohen. There are similarities in the garments worn by the clergy. Ethiopian Orthodox monks wear the priestly belt, the skull cap, and the scapular with 12 crosses. The latter clearly corresponds to the 12 stones on the breastplate of the Jewish high priest. Strict adherence to Pentateuchal legal code prescribing dietary practices is another case of strong Jewish tradition in Ethiopian Orthodox Christianity. Orthodox Christians in Ethiopia follow the dictates of Leviticus regarding the consumption of meat from mammals and birds, sometimes to the smallest detail, as for example in obeying the order in Genesis 32:33 that forbids the consumption of sinew, Ethiopian shuluda. Ethiopian Orthodox Christians never eat animals who do not have cloven hooves or do not chew the cud. Thus, animals such as horses are out of the question. The slaughtering and bleeding of animals is also performed in strict adherence to Pentateuchal requirements as described in Genesis 9 verse 4 and Leviticus 3 verse 17 and 4 verse 6, Ethiopian Christians have added some modern prohibitions also. For example, smoking tobacco, still done by the Oromo Christian converts and widespread even among the clergy in the 16th century, has been banned by the Dersena Raguel, a homily in honor of the archangel Ragu that calls tobacco plant of Setatira and asserts that it is poisoned by the devil. Among all Judeo-Christian people, only Jews and Ethiopians practice circumcision on the eighth day. Baptismal days for infants, as in the Jewish laws of presentation at the temple, are 40 days for males and 80 days for female. Meskel, finding of the true cross. The Meskel feast commemorates what is believed by the Orthodox devout to be the discovery of the true cross, the cross on which Christ was crucified. The finding was attributed to the Empress Helena, mother of Constantine the Great. In Christian Ethiopia, Meskel signifies the physical presence of the true cross at the remote mountain monastery of Gisham Mariam, located 483 kilometers north of Addis Abeba in the Woyo region. In this monastery is a massive volume called the Tefut, written during the reign of Emperor Zare Yaakob, 1434-1468, which records the story of how the fragment of the true cross was acquired by Ethiopia. At the time of year when Meskel is celebrated, flowers bloom on mountains and plains, and the meadows are yellow with brilliant Meskel daisies. Dancing, feasting, merrymaking, bonfires, and gun salutes mark the occasion. The festival begins with the faithful planting a green tree in a town square on the eve of the holiday. Everyone then brings a pole topped with Meskel daisies to form a towering pyramid that becomes a beacon of flame. Torches of common twigs called chibo, are used to light the bundle of branches called damara. In major cities such as Addis Ababa, Meskel celebrations start in early afternoon, when a huge procession bearing flaming torches approaches a central square from various directions. The cavalcade includes priests and deacons in their brightly hued vestments, uniformed students, colorful brass bands, contingents of the armed forces, and bedecked floats carrying huge lit crosses. All the people in the procession circle the damara and fling their torches upon it. Then they welcome the season of flowers and golden sunshine called tsede, whereupon they sing in unison, Ioha Abebaye Meskerem Tebaye, salute my flower, spring has dawned. As evening darkens, the flames glow brighter. It is not until dawn that the burning pyramid consumes itself and the big tree at the center finally collapses. Then, and only then, will the euphoric Christian multitude march home, humming Hallelujah, praise be the Lord, my Savior. Kikanos, according to rabbinical extrapolations of Yasher Shemot, who compiled the Midrashim to the Pentateuch in the 11th century, Kikanos was the king of Ethiopia during Moses' flight from Egypt. Shemot writes that when Moses arrived to take refuge after killing an Egyptian overseer, there was an intractable war between Ethiopia and the nations of the east. In time, Kikanos, with whom Moses gained great favor, died. Then the latter was chosen by the nobles of the land to marry Kikanos' widow, Adonaiah, who was the queen of Ethiopia in her own right. It should be pointed out that Moses' sister Miriam and head priest Aaron disapproved of his marrying this Ethiopian woman. According to the Midrashim of the Pentateuch, Moses soon replaced her husband as king. Moses soon replaced her husband as king of Ethiopia. As a king, Moses was said to have successfully removed the siege of the city and to gain victory against the eastern invaders. The Midrashim further relates that even though Ethiopia was prospering under Moses, who ruled it for 40 years, when he reached the age of 67, the patriarch of the Jews chose to leave Ethiopia. He subsequently returned to Egypt and fulfilled his ordained mission of liberating the children of Israel from Egyptian slavery. The Ethiopian New Year celebration, which falls on September 11th, is similar in religious import to the Jewish New Year. On the morning of the New Year, all Christians go to the nearest river and bathe for purification. This is similar to the immersion prescribed for the high priest in the Mishnah. As soon as the Christian flock returns from the ritual bath in the river, the head of each household sacrifices an animal, usually a bullock, as an act of expiation. This practice clearly resembles the Jewish high priest placing his hand on a bullock prior to its slaughter. Similarly, the Ethiopian Orthodox Easter Fasica is a replication of the Jewish Passover known as Pesach. The observance of the Jewish Sabbath, as well as Sunday, which had been a point of contention among Ethiopian monasteries as well as Orthodox Church scholars and the Jesuits who came to convert Ethiopian Orthodox Christians 500 years ago but without success, is another ancient custom in the Ethiopian Church that resembles a time-honored Jewish tradition. The liturgy of the Ethiopian Church is remarkably similar to that of a Jewish counterpart. Ethiopian Orthodox service books contain the complete Psalter and are followed by the Canon, a collection of 9 odes that are similar to the Jewish Keroba, i.e. the poetical passages inserted into the Tefillah, Hebrew term for prayer. Another clear adherence to Jewish practice is with regard to the Trisagion, which is a standard hymn of the divine liturgy of the Ethiopian Orthodox Church. Aksum Sion. This is the oldest church in Ethiopia, consecrated according to the church tradition by the first Christian co-rulers, the brothers Abraha and Atsbaha, emperors Izana and Zizana, in AD 330. The earliest cathedral had 12 altars, the high altar being dedicated to Saint Mary of Zion. The Virgin Mary is considered the Eternal Queen of Ethiopia. As a result, the church has always been considered the highest ranking and holiest shrine in Ethiopia. Church tradition asserts that Emperor Izana brought the original Ark of the Covenant from the island of Tana Kirkos to Aksum and placed it at its present location. Ethiopian emperors received legitimacy only from this church. The original cathedral was said to have been destroyed by Yudith Gudit, a Beit Israel queen from the Dambia areas, in her quest to seize the Ark of the Covenant, which her group believed was the true Ark of the Covenant given to Moses by God. The cathedral was burned to the ground by Ahmed ibn Ibrahim al-Ghazi Gragnan, who invaded Christian Ethiopia in the 15th century. A newer thought, smaller church replaced the old church during the reign of Emperor Galaudeus. It was in the early 17th century that the cathedral was entirely reconstructed on a grander scale by Emperor Fasiladas. The Ark of the Covenant, which is housed in a small chapel nearby, is guarded by a monk who lives there and is not allowed to leave the compound. The monk stays there for life and is the only person permitted to enter and see the Ark. He appoints his own successor before he dies, and the duty is passed on to the next guardian. By tradition, Saint Mary of Zion is headed by a dignitary with the title of Nibura Id, who also acts as the secular governor of the town of Aksum and its environs. In feudal Ethiopia, the title Nibura Id was equal to the title of Ras or Duke. When a Ras Wark golden coronet was given to the Nibura Id, the dignity outranked that of a Ras. In 1999, by the promulgation of a holy synod, Aksum was elevated to the rank of Archdiocese, and the title of Archbishop of Aksum was reserved for the Patriarch of Ethiopia, whose seat is the capital, Addis Ababa. The Cathedral Monastery of Saint Mary of Zion is referred to as the Ri Issa Adbarat, which means the first among all the churches and monasteries of Ethiopia. The Beit Israel, written records detailing the life of the Ethiopian Jews, or Beit Israel, go to the period of the Middle Ages. Through the Kebre Negesht, was said to have been translated from Arabic in the 14th century. A close historical look shows that the notion of the Queen of Sheba being from northern Ethiopia was not concocted in the 14th century to legitimize the Solomonians. A 9th century Jewish traveler named Elad Hadani referred to a Jewish kingdom beyond the rivers of Kush. He narrated that the Jewish tribe of Dan, in order to avoid the internecine wars between Judah and Israel, migrated to Kush and, finally, with the help of Naphtali, Asher, and Gad, founded an independent Jewish kingdom in the Gold Land, in the vicinity of present-day Ethiopia. Yet others suggest that the Beit Israel were Jewish immigrants who crossed the Red Sea and settled in Ethiopia during Emperor Caleb's conquest of South Arabia in AD 525. As these different hypotheses are advanced, material artifacts depicting ancient Jewish ceremony going to the period of antiquity has been discovered in northern Ethiopia. For example, though a pagan shrine, the temple at Yeha in Tigray province, which was constructed in the 6th century BC, is an architectural reproduction of other Jewish synagogues found in Israel and Egypt during the pre-Babylonian era. With the influence of modern Jewry, post-Israelic feasts are now being celebrated. This started only during the Jewish calendar for the year 5729, 1968-1969. Thus, the Beit Israel have at last joined the annual cycle of contemporary Jewish life. Christianity as the official religion of the Ethiopian realm. There are anecdotal references to the three magi who came to see baby Jesus being Ethiopian. But we clearly see in the New Testament, the Acts 8:26-40, a reference to a eunuch and the treasures of Queen Candace of Ethiopia, an area covering ancient Nubia and parts of the Aksumite Empire, who went to Jerusalem to worship the God of Israel. Another proof that monotheism was already in place in Ethiopia during Christ's early ministry is recounted that the Ethiopian eunuch met Philip the deacon and was baptized by him. Ethiopian historical records assert that he returned home and evangelized Christianity in Ethiopia. Christianity was, however, not widespread. Only a few Ethiopians and Roman merchants practiced Christianity. Up to AD 330, the bulk of the people, including the monarch, remained pagans. It was during that time that Frumentius thought of evangelization. He brought together Christian Ethiopians and Christian merchants of Roman origin who had settled at Aksum and implored them to establish religious meeting places for prayer. Frumentius did not want to see the burgeoning Christian flock in Aksum revert to the previous situation. So he traveled to Alexandria and explained the whole affair to the newly appointed patriarch Athanasius, who he besieged for the appointment of a bishop to minister to the growing Christian community in Aksum that was now protected by a Christian king. After consulting a council of priests, the patriarch chose Frumentius himself to be consecrated as the first bishop of Aksum. Frumentius, known among Ethiopian Orthodox Christians as Abba Selama Kasat-e-Berhan and Father of Peace and Revealer of Light, returned to Aksum to carry out his ministry. Emperor Constantius, son of the first Christian Roman Emperor, Constantine the Great, who had accepted the Arian Creed, which was opposed to the Alexandrian Creed, had written the Ethiopian emperor of the period, Ezana, to request that he oust Frumentius, but the monarch refused to do so. After Frumentius, Ethiopian Christianity spread through the intense evangelization of the nine saints who came to Ethiopia in the 6th century from the Roman Empire. The Magi. The Magi, known as Sabaa, Sagal in Ethiopia, where wise men of the East traveled to Bethlehem with gifts of myrrh, frankincense, and gold to worship the newborn Jesus. Tradition says that these gifts were presented to the Christ child by Balthasar, the dark-colored king from Ethiopia, thus fulfilling Isaiah's prophecy that gold and frankincense would be brought from the Gentiles to honor the heavenly king. Frankincense was the purest incense. When burned, it produced a white smoke that symbolized the prayers and praises of the faithful ascending to heaven. The Western tradition of the names of the Magi originate from an ancient 6th century Greek text translated into Latin. The description resembles a mosaic of the Magi, quite possibly those found at Ravenna. A pseudo-Bedan collection of writings continued to reflect the tradition of three kings. According to one text, the oldest of the Magi was Melchior, who was the king of Arabia. This king is said to have a long gray beard, and he gave gold as a gift, symbolizing the recognition of Christ as king. Balthasar, the king of Ethiopia, was middle-aged, dark-complexioned, and bearded, and gave Jesus the gift of frankincense, indicating the cognition that Christ is the high priest. The last one, Caspar, was said to be the king of Tarsus, and was in his 20s, offered myrrh, which was used in making medicines. This symbolized Christ the healer and paramount physician. All were said to have been guided by the Star of Bethlehem. The Gospel of Matthew does not identify their number, but Christian tradition has set their number at 3. Named them kings Caspar or Gaspar, Melchior, and Balthasar. The Feast of Epiphany, January 6th, commemorates their visit.